And our first speaker is Roman Bessonov from the St. Petersburg University. And he will talk about an almost periodic model for general reflectionless spectral data. Roman, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction. It is actually my first conference, first offline conference after a very long break. And I already enjoy some attention of organizers. So I'm pretty sure that this will be a very nice event. Let's start. I will speak about our joint results. With Milivo Lukic. And Petr Judytsky. The subject is classical relation between, we will discuss relations between certain almost periodic functions or measures and certain reflectionless analytic functions. To start with, let me recall basic notations, basic notation, for example, so I will denote by h of c plus the class of Hilbert functions. In the upper half plane. These functions are analytic in the upper half plane and take it into its closure. The main subject is an interplay between two large classes, reflectionless pairs in this class and almost periodic operators.
Could you please remind what is the Hilbert function?
Analytic function in the upper half plane with this property. So it's just. So I will not speak about any scattering problem today. Yes, this is what I want to discuss right now. Let me give first a definition. First, we will consider a very general notion. So suppose we have functions m plus and minus in C plus. And a Borel subset of the real line of positive Lebesgue measure. We will say that m plus m minus is a reflectionless pair on E if we have the following property. Almost everywhere on E in the sense of non-tangential boundary values. Uh, it should be a bar here of there is a strong relation between these two classes, and let me just to demonstrate one particular case, formulate a theorem by Sonin and Yuditsky. From 1994, actually a particular case of their theorem. Suppose that E is a subset of the real line, closed subset. Such that the complement has finite length. So the complement is, of course, a union of intervals. and we assume that the total length is finite. This is so-called finite gap condition. Let Q be a real continuous function, continuous, even bounded, bounded on R function, and let dq be the corresponding Schrödinger operator with some self-adjoint boundary conditions corresponding to this potential q. Then the following assertions are equivalent. First, half line while functions m plus m minus form reflectionless pair on E. So in fact, we assume that E is an absolutely continuous spectrum of this operator. So we first consider a potential, and then we assume that it's absolutely continuous spectrum. Satisfies this finite gap condition. So the half line while functions form a reflectionless pair on the absolutely continuous spectrum. And the second assertion is Q is uniformly almost periodic. Uniformly almost periodic in the usual sense, the set of shifts is precompact in the Banach space of bounded continuous functions on the real line. Yeah. So this is an example which shows that at least for some, in some situations, this is very closely related objects. We have this if and only if condition. And the aim of the talk is to extend this theorem for spectra satisfying some weaker conditions than this one.
Sorry, how m plus and m minus is related to q? What is the relation between q and m plus?
Well, we associate with this operator two wild functions. We consider the operator, this operator is on the real line. And if we consider two half line operators and to each of them associate the Weyl function, let me not define now what is it. so for these two functions, this will be Herglotz functions. Yeah, we will have reflectionless property, which means this property on the absolutely continuous spectrum. Let me give an example of a very natural spectrum, which cannot be which doesn't satisfy this condition. For example, one can take the following spectrum. Or this one, for example. Clearly, these two examples do not satisfy this condition. But so, of course, for these nice sets, we think that there should be some almost periodic operator for which a result like this holds. More generally, let me define what is homogeneous set. Homogeneous subset of the real line if for every point x in E we have and for every delta bigger than zero we have the following property. The Lebesgue measure of this intersection is bigger than C times delta for some C bigger than zero, which doesn't depend on X. I will use this class of sets in the talk to save time, but in fact, we work with more general class of sets.
Roman, I'm sorry. You did not mention this homogeneity condition in the statement of the theorem Sodin-Yudinsky.
Well, but it's
you only mentioned the length.
Yeah, it should be, yes, it should be, thank you very much, yes, it should be homogeneous also here. In fact, we work with we work in situation under the assumption of Widom condition. And so-called DCT condition, which is for direct Cauchy theorem in the domain C minus E. These are conditions from potential theory. I will not discuss them, but this is the homogeneous sets are examples of such sets with satisfying Widom in DCT conditions. And in fact, our results, these two conditions, Widom and DCT, are more or less necessary and sufficient to our results to hold, for our results to hold. Okay. So the problem now is given a homogeneous set E. Find an almost periodic operator, in some sense almost periodic. I will define it later, for which reflectionless is equivalent to almost periodicity of coefficients. Reflectionless of wild functions and almost periodicity of operator coefficients. And now I'm going to define the class of such operators. In fact, in theorem, we will have not the whole class, not the whole class of these operators, but some subclass. When you consider spectral problems for very general spectral data, it is natural and somehow you don't have much freedom which operators to choose. So you more or less automatically come to canonical Hamiltonian systems. And this is what I would like to define now. Suppose J is a matrix. The non-trivial square root of identity. The canonical Hamiltonian system is the following integral equation. Where mu is a measure, sigma finite measure on the real line. P and Q are 2x2 matrices. P is non-negative. Q star is minus Q. Trace Pj equals to trace Qj is zero. Well, Z is a complex number, a spectral parameter. T is a real number. There are many forms of canonical Hamiltonian systems. This is probably the most general, and it will be convenient for us today. Okay. So now I would like to define accurately what is a wild function. for this, I need the notion of wild disk. So suppose we have a point Z in the upper half plane, number T, and a solution A of the canonical system written here. So the wild disk is the following set. This is the set of complex numbers such that we have the following relation. This is a product of certain matrices, but if you look carefully, so basically it's a number, and we require that this number is non-negative. And the wild disk is the set of all such numbers W such that this expression is non-negative. In fact, if we have a canonical system, then for every T1 less than T2, we have the following property. This is bigger than AT2Z, JAT2Z star. At each complex number in the upper half plane. And this means that actually, if you will look here, think a little bit and realize that this expression is already written here. And this will mean that we have such an exclusion. So AT1 is bigger than, so these disks are nested in fact, and if you consider T1 equal to zero, you will see that this are disks in the disks in the upper half plane. So this is the usual story. The wild function M plus of Z is just the intersection of these disks. And similarly, M minus is a certain is an intersection of certain similar disks, but for a reflected transfer matrix, namely for for this one. I understood that many of you are familiar well with this theory, but I would like to have exact formulas because in a moment we will see some invariants which will be important for the rest of the talk. So anyway, M plus and M minus are now defined mathematically,
and W bigger.
W bigger, sorry, it's just a Kelly transform. The following matrix divided by square root of 2. just a constant matrix. Yeah, thank you. So I will return to invariance in a moment, but now let me first let me formulate the first result. Maybe before the statement, I also need a definition what is almost periodic measure. A complex Borel measure nu is called almost periodic. If first such supremum absolute value of nu is just a total variation. Such a supremum is finite for every compact set K. And second, for every L greater than zero, the function x to this one is uniformly almost periodic. A very natural, x plus, very natural definition, and the theorem. The first theorem says that if the measures P d mu and Q d mu are almost periodic, these are matrix valued measures, but in fact we consider we call matrix valued measures almost periodic if just entries are almost periodic. So if we assume that the coefficients are almost periodic, then m plus m minus is reflectionless on the absolutely continuous spectrum of this problem. Actually, like Sturm-Liouville problem, to this equation one can associate a self-adjoint differential operator. I will not do this accurately, but it has absolutely continuous spectrum. I can just define it in terms of wild functions as a set where m plus is bigger than zero and m minus, the imaginary values of m plus and m minus bigger than zero. And well, essential closure, we need to take essential closure. So this is one direction basically. And this is a easy direction. Anyway, I would like to comment on the statement and explain how to prove it just in words. The idea is very simple, actually. Because of almost periodicity, one can find a sequence of numbers Tn there exists a sequence of numbers Tn tending to plus infinity such that shifted measures just tend to unshifted versions. If these measures are just periodic, you can take period here. But in almost periodic setting, you can always find such numbers. The convergence is actually weak convergence on continuous functions with compact support. And now, if you have such a sequence, these relations could be rewritten in the form that P and Q are right limits of itself, right limits in the sense of Christian Remling. And adapting the proof by Remling, of his famous paper, Absolutely Continuous Spectrum of Jacobi Matrices. Adapting his proof, one can check that any right limit is reflectionless on the absolutely continuous spectrum. But the system is itself a right limit, and therefore it is reflectionless on its spectrum. This is the idea. Okay. So now let me turn to the converse direction, which is somehow more surprising, maybe a bit more interesting. But even for this theorem, it's interesting that we don't have a proof, somehow direct proof, not using Remling's theorem. So Remling's theorem is 2007. For example, that result by Sodin and Tuditsky is 1994. So people know a lot about almost periodicity before Remling's paper, and maybe Christian even did not imagine that his theorem will be applied for this problem. We don't have a direct proof. Anyway, so now let me consider the opposite direction. The first remark is given a reflectionless pair of functions m plus m minus such that m plus m minus are meromorphic on C minus E, where as before E is a set where they are positive, and such that M plus M minus are not zero on this in fact resolving domain C minus E. So given such functions, one can find some canonical Hamiltonian system such that M plus M minus are Weyl functions. Weyl functions of this system. In fact, reflectionless is not needed here, just these conditions. So you just take two Hirschgloss functions, meromorphic on this set, and satisfying these conditions. Then, using a very general theory by Crane and DeBranche, one can find some canonical system generating these functions. The problem. Okay, a naive attempt is to say that, well, maybe this system will be almost periodic if the pair M plus M minus is reflectionless. There is no hope for such result because, in fact, we can find a lot of canonical systems with a given pair of functions M plus and M minus. Why this is so? And here I would like to recall the definitions of Weyl disk. So look here on this expression. If we consider a function, a Yotinner function B ZT, which is of the following form for some increasing increasing bijection kappa from R to R, kappa of 0 is equal to 0, and sum u of t such that u of t j u of t star is j. If we define the following matrices, it turns out that first of all, these matrices will be Yotunov matrices in the sense that they will satisfy such kind of differential equation. This is easy to see if you just differentiate this. And in fact, we will have m plus and m minus for B the same as for A. Indeed, look here, forget about this function kappa. Suppose we have just A and U. So when we plug here, this will, instead of J, we will have U, J, U star, which is just J because of our assumption on U. And this explains why, while disk will be the same. And in particular, the intersection will be the same and the wave coefficients will be the same. Or if you change the function kappa, you will just have here kappa of t, but kappa of t increases. So again, the intersection will be the same. A very deep result by the branch says that this is basically all the freedom you have. So in case you have two canonical systems with the same wave function, then for its solution, we will have this relation. And now the problem is to choose in some way the function u and the function kappa so that almost periodicity will be the same as reflectionless property. And it was completely non-clear which u and kappa to choose here. And the answer is to choose u so that this new function b with the same wave function will satisfy so-called RF condition, which is in fact of the following form. So for every t, you will have matrix of the form A1 of t, say B1 of t, B2 of t, B of t, 0 for some B1, 2, non-negative. And as kappa, you need to choose such functions so that the exponential type of B z kappa of t with respect to Martin function at infinity will be equal to t. Martin function is a certain object from potential theory. Basically, it's a green function of our domain, which I assume to be unbounded. And so Martin function, symmetric Martin function at infinity is a certain green function. So with this choice, that's probably, yes, more or less the end of my talk. So with this choice, almost periodicity and reflectionless is the same. And actually, we prove much more. We characterize all wild functions corresponding to a given spectra and so on and so on. The paper is about two papers in in common. It's about 80 pages, so there is a lot of theory. And for today, the aim was just to give a test of the results. So if you're interested, everything is on archive. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Roman. Any questions? Pavel Lushnikov, please use microphone.
Okay, my question maybe will be somewhat too general. So it was work several years ago of Vladimir Zakharov and collaborators who constructed non-periodic reflectionless potentials for Schrodinger operator. Question if there is any way to basically look on limits of a construction to U case of almost periodic function, which of course will be reduction. At least we have constructive procedure to produce reflectionless potential. I'm not sure if you have just theorem, you don't have, I think.
We actually have examples. Formula. we actually have formula for coefficients. Everything is very constructive compared with previous theorem by Sodin and Yudisky, where finite zone approximation methods were used. Everything is very constructive in the paper, so I think that something you speak about is possible, but I'm not ready to comment it.
Yeah, of course, it's very general comment. I think it's somewhat from not exactly your field, right, but we're also looking for reflectionless potential and even more general non-periodic case. So I think it might be interesting relation.
Yes, thank you.
Any other question?
Roman, do I understand correctly that this is one of the first attempts to put Remling theorem in a frame of the branch canonical system?
Actually, the Remling himself proved a beautiful result about this absolutely continuous spectrum, and probably his result should be better known.
Canonical system.
He also have some version for canonical system, but in our case, we need a little bit different story. It's actually one of the first results about this. But interestingly, that in our case it was an instrument. It's what not aim. Yes, the beautiful result of Remling is just. Self-contained results of self-interested. We adapt the technique of Remling in our situation to prove the first part.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Maybe online questions? Okay, if there is no question, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.